This is the True Racers Podcast. Come along with us as we discover racing's past, present, and everything in between. Welcome to the True Racers Podcast. I'm your host, Greg Campbell. On today's episode, we're going to have another one of our racing short stories. Matter of fact, we've got three. Now, all three of these incidents happened at the Concord Motor Speedway, a track that has been very significant in my personal racing history. So I'm excited to share them with you today. So let's get right to it. All right, this first story takes place at the Concord Motor Speedway, back during the time of the Big Ten Series. Now, for those of you who don't know, the Big Ten Series was a series at Concord Motor Speedway that Henry Lee Furr started. It obviously was 10 races, and they were stretched out over the season. We ran about once a month. And these races were 200 laps, and they attracted teams from all over the country. I mean, guys like Garrett Evans that came all the way from Washington, and Butch Miller, and Jeff Purvis, and just Rich Bickle, Freddie Query, Mike Thomas. I mean, the list goes on and on. At one time, there was, 30, 40 cars showing up for each one of these races, and they paid pretty good money and had a pretty good points fund at the end of the year. So it was a big deal. And so I was crew chief for Jerry McCart, and we were running and been running there for a couple of seasons and gotten where we were running pretty good. And at the time, we had a Carl Wegner 9-1 Pontiac head, aluminum head engine, and it ran really good. And that's pretty much what everybody else had, a version of that. And so we ran pretty good and, was able to run with them and ran real competitive and, would finish in the top five in points every year. But at one point, a few of the teams got this new engine that Carl Wegner had out. It had Buick heads on it, and they were... This engine was a rocket ship. I mean, it was, you could really launch coming off the corner and just pull away from whoever you were racing with. And it was just really a fast engine. And basically, we couldn't compete with it. I mean, you could not run with these with what we had. And so, at that time, the way the Big Ten races were, you qualified and they took the top six. And those top six were locked into the feature. Everybody else had to run a heat race. And depending on how many cars were there might be three, four, five, sometimes even six heat races. And they would take so many out of each heat race, and they would go into the feature. And, I believe they had some kind of last chance race, but if you didn't make it then, you just went home. And those heat races were kind of rough because, I said, there's a lot of cars there trying to make this race, and so they got a little rough at times. And it seemed like every time we ran one, you'd bang up the body or, you'd hit the radiator, the oil cooler, or bend the spindle, or bend the rear end tube, and just anything that you had to stay up all night trying to fix. And so it was getting tough. I mean, for a small budget team, every time you tear up something, that's money out of your budget. So, I was the kind of crew chief that I wasn't going to get beat long. I mean, if somebody had an advantage over me, I was going to figure something out to, at least run with them, if not, outrun them. And so I got to thinking about it, and I decided I was going to put a set of soaked tires on for qualifying, which I did. And I think we qualified sixth. We just kind of squeaked in because, with that engine and everything the way it was, the soft tires really didn't help you that much. It helped you enough to get close to them, but, you still couldn't run with them. And we didn't run them in the race because, these were 200-lap races, so frankly, soaked tires wasn't going to last, 20, 30 laps. So, we didn't even attempt to run them in the race. In the race, we just hoped that, our car would handle better longer, and maybe they'd have some trouble, and, we'd get a good finish. And most of the time, we did get a good finish. Qualifying come, we put the soaked tires on. Like I said, I think we qualified sixth, so we were in the feature. Didn't have to run heat races. And then we ran the race, and I think we finished pretty good. But then the next race, I did the same thing. And, we was able to get into the top six. I think we qualified fifth the second time we did it. And, so I thought, well, gosh, I got something. At least we can get in the race and not have to fool them heat races. So the third race we went back to, I had a plan to do that again, and which I did. And as you qualified, if you looked like you were going to be a pretty top speed, they'd pull you off to the side, you know. And so there's about two or three cars left to qualify. And Dave Allman, who was the head tech man there, he walked by and he said, "Y'all don't go anywhere. I'm going to check tires after this is over with." And what that meant was, at that time, most of the guys checked tires. They had what they called a sniffer. And for those of you who don't know, it was an electronic device that detected accelerants. And most tire softeners had some type of accelerant in it, because you had to have something to, you know, that would seep into the rubber and change the chemical makeup of the tire, which, you know, would soften it. And so when he said that, I panicked. I just thinking, oh gosh, he's going to catch us. Everybody's going to raise hell. They're probably going to throw us out. We're not going to get the race. I mean, all these things are going through my mind. Well, then I go into, you know, problem-solving mode. What can I do? How can I get these tires off this car? My wheels are spinning. And I'm thinking, do I need to go find the breaker to cut the lights off with the racetrack? Do I call in a bomb threat? Which, just kidding, if any of you law enforcement out there are listening, I wouldn't do that. But I even thought about the old James Bond movie, Goldfinger, where Pussy Galore flies over with her flying circus and sprays out a nerve gas that knocked everybody out for a few minutes, you know. Just kind of crazy things that go through your mind when you're trying to figure out how to get out of trouble. And finally, I just decided that I was going to do something outlandish, something you never, ever do at a racetrack. I was going to tell the truth. So I went over to Dave Allman, and Dave Allman was a very good official. I mean, you know, we'd been running there for years, so I'd gotten to know him pretty good, and he knew me. And, you know, you kind of got to be friends with the officials, you know, as far as you can be as friends with an official, because his job is to be impartial. And but he was very good at what he did and was just a very good person. And so I went and put my arm around his shoulder, and I said, "Dave, I got a set of soaks on my car." And he kind of pulled away from me and looked at me like, "What in the world did you just say?" And I said, "Yeah, I said I got a set of soaks on my car." And I said, "I'm going to tell you why." I said, "We can't run with these guys." I said, "We get stuck in them heat races every time." And I said, "We get all beat up and banged up." And I said, "You know, small budget team like us, we can't afford to fix too much of this stuff. We ain't going to be able to come back." And I said, "So I had to do something." I said, "We just cannot run with them guys." And so he asked me, he said, "Are you running them in the race?" I said, "No, sir." I said, "I don't run them in the race because, you know, they wouldn't last for one thing. And, you know, and I don't want to take a chance on that." So I said, "Well, Dave, you know, if you want to catch me, you know, turn your sniffer on. If you don't want to catch me, then turn it off." And I turned around and walked away. Didn't say anything. He didn't say anything. I just turned around and walked away. So the last two or three qualifiers qualified, and here he comes with a sniffer. And I think we were about the fourth car in line. So he starts at the first car and checks it, and second car, third car. Well, he gets to us, and I just turn around. I didn't even look. I was looking up at the stands. And I hear him fumbling around with the valve stem cap. And I hear him, you know, he'd let a little air out so that, you know, the sniffer would pick up the accelerant in the air that was in the tire. And so I heard the air coming out, and I'm waiting for this machine to, it makes a little buzz and sort of an electronic noise, and I kept waiting to hear that noise, and I didn't hear it. And I heard him getting up, so I turned around, and he went to the next car. I didn't look at him. I didn't say thank you. I didn't even acknowledge it. I just acted like it didn't happen. So we went on, and we got in the race, went on, run the race, and I think we finished in the top five. And so sometime between this race and the next race, Jerry was able to get one of these engines from Carl Wegner. I don't remember exactly how he was able to do that, but he got one. We got it in the car and went up to the race and was out practicing. And, I mean, this thing is a rocket ship. We were like 6 or 7 tenths faster than we were with the other engine. I mean, we were right there with Bickle and Query and Mike Thomas. And so we came in after practice and we're getting the car prepared for the race. And or for qualifying, that is. And about 30 minutes before qualifying, Dave walks up to me and puts his arm around me and kind of walks me off away from the trailer over by herself. And he said, "Look," I know you got one of those engines, and I've had my stopwatch out, and you're right there with the other guys that you couldn't outrun before. He said, you got what they got, so I'm turning my sniffer back home. And I said, fair enough, Dave. I appreciate it. And he walked off, and, you know, we qualified, and I think we qualified third that night. And, you know, never had to, had an issue with that again. But I'll tell you something. You know, I'm thinking about that, and we lost Dave Allman in 2012, and I really hate that because he was just such a super guy, and you really enjoyed, you know, racing with him. And but, you know, he didn't have to do that. And he was the type of official that realized that, you know, sometimes you got to help the competitors out, especially the ones that are kind of low-buck racers, you know, that are just trying to make every race. And, you know, if you can help them out, get to each race, that's what it's all about, because if there's no competitors, there's no series. And he got that. And I'm sure he probably helped other teams out over the years, you know, that needed a, you know, a leg up or a helping hand or something like that. And I really appreciate him doing that. And, you know, just I've dealt with a lot of officials over the years, and he was the tops. And, you know, I really hate it that he's gone, and but really enjoyed the time we spent with him. So, but that was a cool story. I hope you enjoyed that, and we'll be right back. If you enjoy listening to different podcasts, have you ever thought you'd like to have your own podcast, but thought, it's not possible, it's too hard, or too expensive, I just don't know what to do? Well, there's a tool available that allows you to record and edit your podcast right from your computer or your smartphone. Anchor.fm, which is available in your app store, will distribute your podcast for you so that it can be heard on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can also make money with your podcast with no minimal listenership. Anchor supplies everything you need to produce a podcast all in one place. So download the free Anchor app or go to the website at anchor.fm, that's Anchor, A-N-C-H-O-R.fm, and get started today. So stop dreaming and start podcasting. Now, this next story, it takes place at Concord Motor Speedway as well. And I'm still crew chief for Jerry McCart. And Concord Motor Speedway was, it was a lot like a dirt track. I mean, it would change a lot, you know, from race to race. And like I said, the Big Ten series, we'd run about once a month. So you might go up there one for one race, and you'd find out in practice that you needed to run sticker tires to qualify, because that was the fast, you know, setup. And then you'd go back for the next race, and scuffs would be the hot ticket. So you never really knew, but you figured that out in practice which way you needed to go. So the way qualifying worked there, you had a certain time that qualifying started, and you didn't have to draw for a qualifying order or anything like that. You just got in line when you got ready. And you know, and there was a cutoff time. If you were in line when that time got there, you could qualify. If you weren't in line, you didn't get to qualify. So with that type of deal, there was a lot of cat and mouse games that went on with qualifying, you know, like, you know, the temperature, everybody waiting to go at a certain time, and, you know, everybody piling down pit road at the same time, or maybe somebody going first, or you know, there was just a lot of games being, head games being played with teams, you know, trying to get any advantage you could get. And so I started thinking about things that I could do. You know, what's something I can do to, you know, kind of get in these guys' heads a little bit and maybe get a little bit of advantage. And I was watching practice, and I was sitting on the pit wall, and Freddie Querrey came out of the pits, and he had on a set of stickers, and he was going out to practice, probably going out to figure out what he needed to do. And I saw him going down pit road, and I saw, you know, on a brand new sticker tire, there's a sticker, thus the name. The white little decal that, you know, they put on every tire that told what it was and all that. But you see those things, every time the tire would rotate, you'd see that white. And it was like, you know, it was almost like a neon sign. It'd go down pit road, and you'd say, okay, he's on stickers. There was no doubt. And so that got me to thinking. And so we had already decided in practice that scuffs were, you know, the way to go. And so I got my tires ready and everything, got them on the car, and right before we let it down, I took a roll of white 2-inch duct tape and I cut off four little 5-inch strips and I put them on the tire. And so I made sure that we were about the first or second car to go out. And so we got down there, I think we were the third car to go out. And so as we started down pit road, you could look and you could see there was those white labels, you know, and it appeared we had sticker tires on our car. So Jerry went out and busted off a good lap. I think he went to the top of the board with that. We ended up like third, but he went to the top of the board. And man, everybody went running over to their trailer, bringing back jacks and lug wrenches and new sticker tires and everything. And all of them didn't fall for it. There was a few didn't fall for it. Bickle didn't fall for it, and Freddie Query didn't fall for it. But a bunch of them did. And we out-qualified every one of them. And that's like I say, I think we ended up third behind Bickle and Query. So that was kind of cool that I was able to do that. And, you know, that's what made racing fun at Concord, because there wasn't, you know, a lot of structure. You kind of did what you wanted to do, and, you know, you could play a lot of head games with teams, and that's what was fun. You know, you didn't have to draw for position. You could go when you wanted to, and there was a lot of strategy and just a lot of, you know, thinking, trying to get in people's heads, because to me, that's the easiest place to pass somebody's on pit road. If you can snooker them in the pits instead of having to beat on them out on the racetrack, that's the, you know, the easiest way to go. So, but that was really cool. I really enjoyed that, and just really enjoyed the whole time we spent at Concord. And I'm sure y'all probably had some experiences like that as well. But that one was a cool one. Now, this last story takes place at Concord Motor Speedway as well, and still working for Jerry McCart. Now, this story doesn't have anything to do with a race or strategy or, you know, anything having to do with the competitive side of it. We'd gone up for the race, had a good race, got all loaded up, you know, ready to head back to Georgia. And we were kind of standing around the truck, just kind of talking to other people and stuff about the race and stuff and getting ready to head back. And at that time, you know, all the competitors, you know, we raced really hard on the racetrack and, you know, beat on each other and maybe argued a little bit afterwards. But when it was all over with, we were like one big family. I mean, we were just, you know, we were friends. And a lot of times we would go out at night after the, you know, the racing activities and, you know, just enjoyed each other's company. Just like one big family. So we were standing there talking, and all of a sudden I look up, and here comes Larry Raines with his signature grin. And if you know Larry Raines, you're going to enjoy this story. If you don't know Larry Raines, you're missing something. Google Larry Raines and just see what you find out. Now, Larry was a competitor at Concord, too, and was a tough competitor. He ended up winning the championship there one year, and was always a threat, you know, to win. And so he was a tough racer. And so, and he was from Georgia as well, so, you know, we knew him and had known him for a long time. I actually worked for Larry as a tire changer for a few races and always enjoyed working with him. But he come walking up, had the grin on his face, and we talked a few minutes about how he ran, about how we ran. And all of a sudden he says, can I catch a ride with y'all back to Georgia? And, you know, we all looked at each other and was like, well, yeah, sure, Larry, no problem, but why do you need a ride? He said, well, they all left me. We kind of laughed, and I said, well, Larry, you know, I mean, I watched the race. I saw, you know, you ran pretty good. I didn't think you ran that bad for them to leave you. So he said, well, we had the race rig, and then we had another car, and each person thought I was in the other vehicle. And so they left me. And now this is pre-cell phone, so there's no calling them or anything like that. They're gone. And so we said, sure, get in. So he got in the truck with us and rode back, and we got close to where he lived. We got off the highway and found a pay phone. And he called somebody, and they came and got him. And but that's the coolest story. I mean, it's just, like I say, if you know Larry Raines, you'll have to really know him to find a lot of humor in this. But it was just really funny. And one of those stories that has stuck with me all these years, I mean, it's been 20-plus years, and I still remember it like it happened yesterday. And I see Larry every now and then, at, maybe a funeral or some kind of racing gathering or something like that. And I always remind him of that story. I always make sure. I said, "Now, Larry, you got to ride home, don't you?" And we get a big laugh out of it. And I get that signature Larry Raines grin. And Larry's just a really positive person. I mean, I've seen him mad before, and he's still got that grin on his face. So he's just always a good person to be around. You always have a lot of fun when you're around Larry Raines. And I'll always remember that story. That's just one of those stories that stick with you no matter how long you live. And it's just a good memory for me, and I really enjoyed it.
Boy, I hope you enjoyed hearing these stories as much as I did remembering them. It's so much fun for me to remember and relive these things that I've experienced over the years. And I just really like sharing these experiences with you. Now, in the past few months, since we started this podcast, we've gotten so many emails, Facebook, and Twitter messages telling us how much you like the podcast. And I just want to say thank you for all your comments and support. It means a lot to us, and we really appreciate it. So if you like what you hear, or if you have a comment or suggestion, or if you have a racing short story of your own that you'd like to share with us, send us an email at trueracerspodcast@yahoo.com and let us know. You can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. If you'd like more information on this podcast, log on to our website at trueracerspodcast.com. So until next time, you know what I always say. Get out and support your local racetracks. They really need your support right now. So get out and enjoy some great short track racing. And keep supporting those true racers. Thank you. Goodbye.